goodness with care from our villages Arokya milk.
Welcome to episode 11 of Mahabharata with Anuja. Let me warn you, this is one of the most heartbreaking episodes in the Mahabharata, and it started out over a simple matter. Now, the Pandavas had just concluded the Rajasuya Yaga. It had been a huge success, and the Kauravas, led by Duryodhana, had stayed on for a few days, for a little while, to enjoy the hospitality of the brothers. And now, it was all going well actually, but there were a couple of small childish incidents. Duryodhana and the Kauravas were made to feel like they were country bumpkins in a very fancy establishment. They looked around, they saw the pomp and splendor of the Pandavas, which everyone was comparing to Amaravati, Indra's celestial abode, and Duryodhana accidentally walked into a wall thinking that it was, you know, an open, just an opening for him to go out. And there were other incidents like this. Him and his brothers, they'd lift up their garments thinking that they were about to enter a pool of water, but it'll be just a flow. Or they'll just walk thinking it's a crystal paved decorative segment and it'll actually be a pool and they'll get wet, and there'll be laughter all around, and people will just laugh. Nobody means any harm, it's very juvenile, it's sort of like schoolyard antics. And Draupadi also had laughed, and seeing Draupadi and the other women laugh, Duryodhana was very hurt, and it should have not been blown out of proportion, but it was. Duryodhana returned to Hastinapura and he was in a blue funk, sick with envy. And as always, Shakuni, Karna and Dushasana, they tried to comfort him by coming up with increasingly evil ideas. And finally, Shakuni said, "I have the perfect plan. Yudhishthira loves to gamble, but he has zero talent. Let him play against me. Invite him for a game of dice and I'll win everything he has for you." And Duryodhana thought this was brilliant, and they decided to ask Dhritarashtra to extend an invitation because they knew Yudhishthira wouldn't be able to refuse. And Vidura spoke strongly against it, so did Bhishma and Drona, but there was no reasoning with Duryodhana. And things came to a pass, the invitation was extended, and Yudhishthira's well-wishers, they did tell him, "Please don't accept this. Nothing good will come of it. Duryodhana will definitely ask Shakuni to play. The dice will be loaded. You will lose everything." And Yudhishthira said, he said something ridiculous about Dharma. He said, "In all honor, I can't turn down a challenge. And besides, Dhritarashtra has invited us. He's our king. I have to go." And so he dragged his brothers and his wife to their doom. They all made their way to Hastinapura. Yudhishthira protested very feebly, you know, when Shakuni said he will be playing for Duryodhana. Duryodhana will only provide the stakes. And Yudhishthira said that's not how it's supposed to be done. But, as usual, he gave in, and the game commenced. They started with small stakes, jewelry, stuff like that. And then the stakes started getting bigger, bigger. And Yudhishthira lost every single hand. And finally, he decided to stake his youngest brother, Sahadeva. Sahadeva was lost, and then Nakula was lost, and Shakuni, Karna and Dushasana, they were conferring, and they were scared that Dhritarashtra, would put an end to things, or Yudhishthira would finally stop gambling. So Shakuni goaded him a bit. He said, "What is this? You gambled away Madri's sons first. Is that because you're partial to Arjuna and Bhima?" And Yudhishthira was angered. He rose to the bait. He said, "No, all my brothers are equal to me." And he staked Arjuna next. Lost him, Bhima. Finally, he lost himself as well, and he was just standing there with nothing to gamble, and it was like really sad to see him like that. And then Shakuni, very softly, he said, "You have something else in your possession. Why don't you play with that? And who knows, you may win everything back." And Yudhishthira looked up with dull eyes. Shakuni said, "What about your wife, your common wife, Draupadi? Why not stake her and play?" And all the elders said, "Shame." They said, "Fie, don't do this, Yudhishthira." But Yudhishthira, he'd taken leave of his senses. He immediately staked Draupadi, and she was lost as well. And there was huge celebrations on the side of the Kauravas. It was very, very It was just too awful for words. And then Karna said, now Draupadi can be our maid along with the Pandavas. She's fit only for sweeping and swabbing and all. It was a very ugly suggestion, but Duryodhana was very happy to hear it. He turned to Vidura. He said, go and fetch Draupadi. She belongs to us now. And Vidura glared at him. He said, do you know what you're doing? You've dragged us all to the very brink of doom. Back off now, don't do anything. We're all going to regret. But Duryodhana just ignored him. He turned to his charioteer, a man named Pratikami. He said, go bring her. Tell her she's been ordered to come here. She belongs to us now. And this charioteer felt so bad, but he couldn't disobey this order. He went, he was trembling, he stood in front of Draupadi. He told her everything that had happened, and Draupadi couldn't believe her ears. She said, did that gambler lose his wife? Are you joking? Then she said, go back and ask all those elders gathered there. Ask whether Yudhishthira lost himself first. If he'd lost himself, then I don't belong to him either. So I don't need to go. So, she was trying to work her way out of this. Pratikami went back, he reported what she'd said. He repeated her question. And immediately Duryodhana said, no, we can't debate the rights and wrongs of it and all. What? She's acting like a queen here. She's a maid. He immediately called Dushasana. He said, you go and bring that Draupadi here. And Dushasana was very happy to do this. This monstrous man, he went to Draupadi and he said, come. Don't make me ask twice. And Draupadi was horrified to see this, and she didn't want to beg to Dushasana of all the people. She said, I'm in a delicate condition, I'm wearing just a single cloth. What she meant was that she was menstruating at the time. She said, it's not fit for me to be in an assembly of men right now. Don't do this. And he just laughed. He said, who cares about your delicate sensibilities right now? And she turned and she fled. She wanted to make her way to Gandhari's chambers and beg for her protection. But Dushasana grabbed her by the hair and he pulled her by the hair all the way to the assembly. And he tossed her down there in front of all the people gathered. And Draupadi would not be shamed. She stood up, she held herself erect. There were tears running down her cheeks, but she was proud and she glared at all the men seated there. She said, is this your idea of justice? Will you stand by and allow this to happen to a good woman? And then she looked at Bhishma. She said, Bhishma, will you allow this to happen to me? You're the grandsire. She turned to Drona. She said, can you stand there and witness what is happening? And everybody kept silent. Nobody would answer her. And then she asked again. She said, if Yudhishthira lost himself first, how can he play with me as a stake? Answer me. Everybody kept silent. Everybody. Only Vikarna spoke up. He was one of the Kauravas, one of the younger ones. He stepped forward. He said, Draupadi is right. Yudhishthira was not in a position to stake her, so it's invalid. And Karna immediately said, you're a young fellow. What do you know? She has no rights in the Sabha. She can't even speak without our permission. We should make the Pandavas and Draupadi disrobe. Even their clothes belong to us. And immediately the Pandavas were all looking down. None of them could meet Draupadi's gaze, because she was giving them this look of withering scorn that they'd put her in this position. They stripped down and they just stood there with their eyes lowered. And Draupadi again, she turned round. She asked Dhritarashtra, she said, you will not open your eyes to this evil. Will you allow this to happen to me? And the king was silent. Nobody would answer her. And Duryodhana said, enough of all this talk. Dushasana, her clothes belong to us. And once more, Dushasana approached her. Okay, and he grabbed her sari. At that point, she wouldn't even look at her husband's, but she wouldn't let her courage abandon her either. She joined her hands in prayer. She looked up and she said, Krishna, you're my best friend. All these men here, Bhishma, Vidura, none of them, my five strong, valiant husbands, none of them can come to my rescue. But you are there. While you're there, I will not be afraid. She shut her eyes and Dushasana was pulling her sari. It was the most shameful thing ever. He was pulling and pulling, but her entire being was focused on Krishna. Now, Krishna and Draupadi had a very special, sweet relationship. When Drupada had thought that Arjuna was dead, he'd always wanted Arjuna as his son-in-law. But at that time when he figured that the Pandavas had been killed at Varanavata, he had approached Krishna. He said, you become my son-in-law, I need a strong warrior and you're the best. And Krishna would have told him at that time, your daughter is meant for my friend, my cousin. I will not accept her, but she will be as my, you know, as my cousin's wife, she'll be my sister. As my friend's wife, she'll be my friend. So ever since Draupadi and Krishna would have been very close, and at that moment Krishna wasn't there, and yet he was there for Draupadi. He did not let her down. Dushasana pulled and pulled and pulled, but a fresh garment would replace the one before, and it went on and on, and finally the mighty Dushasana of the extremely beefy arms, he was completely drained of all his strength and he just collapsed in a faint, and there was a huge pile of garments there. And Draupadi, you know, held her hands across her chest and she glared at all the men there. There was murder in her gaze and they were all terrified. And at that point Bhima had had enough. He said, Dushasana, that hand which disrobed my wife, no, I will tear it out in battle and I will drink the blood from your chest. He said this. And Duryodhana just laughed at that, and looking at Draupadi, he lifted up his garment and he showed her his thighs and he invited her to sit there. You know, it was a very ugly gesture, and Bhima turned to him also. He said, I will smash those thighs in battle, see if I don't. And Arjuna turned on Karna. He said, it was your suggestion that led to all this. I will kill you in battle, make no mistake. Sahadeva stepped forward. He said, Shakuni, you're a cheater and a coward. You will meet your end at my hand, and your evil son Ulluka will be killed by Nakula. Now hearing all this, Dhritarashtra, for the first time in his life, he gathered his courage and he did the right thing. He turned at once to Draupadi. He said, step forward, daughter-in-law. You're so virtuous. You're a good woman. This should not have happened to you. Please come to me. Accept a boon from me. I can't undo what happened, but accept a boon from me. She immediately said, give my five husbands their freedom. He said, it's granted, they will have their freedom back. Ask for another boon. She said, restore all their possessions to them. Restore everything that has been lost to them. And Dhritarashtra agreed again. He said, everything will be restored to your husbands. So, you know, Draupadi had saved them, you know, from what had happened. But, you know, things were destined to be, alas. The brothers all returned. At that point, they did return. They gathered their clothes and heartsick and weary, they turned to leave for Indraprastha. But Duryodhana would not have it. He said, I worked so hard and that old man, with just, you know, using just words, he's given everything back. I won't allow it. We have to get it all back. And then Shakuni said, invite him to play again. This time we'll send them off into exile. So the invitation was extended yet again. And again, Draupadi, all of them begged Yudhishthira not to go back and gamble. But Yudhishthira, this time he quoted the Ramayana. He said, there never was, you know, a golden deer. There never will be a golden deer. And Rama still went after the deer, thinking there was one. So what's meant to happen is meant to happen. And speaking nonsense like this, Yudhishthira went back. And this time he lost again. And he was condemned to spend 13 years in exile. The 13th year will have to be spent in hiding, and if the Pandavas were caught out, they would have to go into exile for another
13 years.
These were the terms. And the Pandavas left for the second time, having lost everything. They wore very clothes of bark, and they left for the forest. They were extremely sorry about what had happened. Vidura couldn't bring himself to offer any comfort. He couldn't find the words. He just embraced them and he said, let me do what I can for you. Kunti is old now. So please don't take your mother this time. Leave her in my care. I will take good care of her. So Kunti also, you know, she consoled Draupadi as best as she could. And she sent all of them into exile. And she was praying that they would be kept safe. And the brothers and Draupadi, they left for the exile. Now, meanwhile, sage Narada, he came to the palace at Hastinapura and he said,
13 years
from now, the Kauravas will be destroyed. And he disappeared from there. Hearing this, Duryodhana was quite freaked out. He went to Dronacharya and he begged for his protection. Drona said, don't worry, I've eaten of your salt. I will always be loyal to you. And immediately the Kauravas felt better. Meanwhile, the Pandavas were inconsolable. Draupadi had refused to tie her hair again. She said, you know, Bhima, till you fulfill your oath, my hair will remain like this. And finally, she could no longer be strong. She started sobbing softly. And the brothers simply could not watch her, you know, being so sad. And they all lowered their eyes and they just walked slowly. They trudged towards the forest. And there were quite a few people following them. They said, Dhritarashtra is evil. The Kauravas shouldn't have done this. We will come with you into exile. And Yudhishthira turned around. He said, he's still your king. He's my uncle. Don't, dishonor him by talking like this. Go back. Go back to your homes. We will come back. And Yudhishthira wasn't sure. He believed it. But they proceeded along. And all the holy men and all refused to go back. They continued following them. And Yudhishthira was thinking, it's bad enough. I've brought my brothers and my wife to this situation. Now these people also are placing their lives in my hands. How will I even feed them? Where will I find food for this large gathering? And sage Daumya approached him. He said, why don't you worship the sun? He will offer a solution to all your problems. The sun is the provider of light as well as food. So Yudhishthira worshipped Surya, and Surya appeared before him, and he gave him the marvelous Akshaya Patra. He gave it, and he said, whatever Draupadi prepares on this dish, you know, it'll be enough to feed everyone who's there with you. And once she's consumed her meal at sundown, the vessel will empty itself again. So, you know, they felt better. This was such a blessing. And all the brothers felt slightly better. But as they proceeded again, they were sunk into gloom and depression. And all their well-wishers came to see them. Krishna came, Drishtadyumna came, Satyaki was there. Some of their allies, they all came, they all commiserated with them. They all offered advice. And Krishna said, if I had been there, I would have put a stop to things. But Dwaraka was under siege and I could not make my way back here. He said, don't worry, the 14 years will pass in a trice. Everything you've lost will be restored to you. And Drishtadyumna also, he couldn't, say anything because Draupadi was his twin sister. And he felt her pain and he knew that Drupada hadn't even been able to come. This was exactly what Drupada had been afraid of. He said, if my daughter marries 5 men, people will not respect her. And it had all happened just as he feared. And, Drishtadyumna again, he was thinking, my sister had actually chosen Arjuna at her Swayamvara. Nobody asked her consent. You know, she was made to marry all 5 and then Yudhishthira has done this to her. So he was sitting there in silence, he was brooding. But finally, you know, he didn't want to add to their grief. So he only said, don't worry, I will look after the Upa Pandavas. These were Draupadi's sons. He said, don't worry about them. I will treat them better than my own sons. And once you come back, I will restore them to you. Krishna also volunteered to take Subhadra and Abhimanyu with him. And the Pandavas were easier in mind because at least their loved ones would be safe. Okay? And with their advice, all of them left. And finally, it was Vedavyasa's turn to console them. And he said, the Pandavas are going to, going through a rough patch right now. But it will be over soon. The Kauravas will live a life of selfish indulgence. They'll spend, they'll gamble, and you know, they'll live lavishly. They won't do anything good. So, you know, nothing good will happen to them either. You spend these 13 years helping as many people as you can. Do charitable things, travel to holy spots, think good thoughts, fortify yourself. Everything will work out well. So with these soothing words, he also taught Yudhishthira something very valuable. He taught him the art of Pratismriti. He said it will help you, it will help Arjuna in particular, remember this. And so with all this, they all left and the Pandavas resigned themselves. They had that stiff upper lip. They decided to go for it and bear it. This concludes episode 11 of Mahabharata with Anuja. Be sure to tell me what you thought about the whole Draupadi episode. It really gets to me every time and I'm sure you feel as strongly about it as I do. Share your thoughts with me in the comments section. I will see you next time with more from the Mahabharata. In the meantime, please do hit like, share and subscribe to our channel. Thank you so much.
Goodness with care. From our villages, Arokya Milk.